lower organisms. Now let's move on further in this chapter. We have the next concept is there is evolution. Evolution means it is a process of slow and a gradual change in which simple organism become advanced or complex. It is nothing but you maybe have gone through the history of a mankind. It was believed that the first the humans are then their ancestors are chimpanzees and the monkeys. Later on they have been transformed, now present what we are looking. It is nothing but we can say a simple one have been become more complex and advanced. To explain that concept, they have took certain example. One of the example, it is related to the variation itself. The headline we have as variation may or may not be helpful to the organism to get survival. In your textbook of NCERT, you have a three illustrative examples with a diagrammatic representation. There is a in the first illustration, we have some group of red beetles who are living in green bushes. And in that all the red beetles, we have only one green beetle. And you know that crow will feed upon the beetles. But the crow can see the red beetle, but it can't see the green beetle. So the crow, which it can see the red beetle, it will feed and it will eat the beetle. Whereas the green beetle who have been not survived, they will increase their population by means of reproduction. Here, what the point we can conclude, there is the green beetle have got survival advantage. It has been selected by the nature, or it will be considered as a fit test for the nature to be survived. That is only I have illustrated here. There are some of the beetles living in the green bushes, they increase their number of by the reproduction. Crows can easily see the red beetle and they are eaten by the crows. During the reproduction, due to some of the variations, some green beetles are produced instead of the red beetles. The green beetles are not visible to the crow and they are not eaten by them. Then gradually the population of the red beetle get decreases and the population of green beetle get increased. This variation has helped the organism to get survive. But for this, I will give one hint point to be remembered, that is survival advantage. In the same manner, there is another one illustrative example have been given in your textbook. Once again, some red beetles have been living in the green bushes. In that we have few blue colored beetles. Suddenly, one elephant have impacted upon that, and in the base of the foot of the elephant, maximum red beetles were being killed. It was an accident. And due to this event, there is some changes happen in the genes of the blue beetle, and the blue beetle, they increase their population. And what happened here, there is some kind of changes have been done in the frequency of the genes of the blue beetle. So for this I will give you one hint point to be remembered as a genetic drift. So due to the genetic drift, some random changes happen in the frequency of the genes and suddenly they increase their population. So for that, there is a reproduction in the color of variation occur in the red beetle and some blue beetles are produced instead of the red beetles. Both in the red and blue beetles are invisible to the crow and are eaten by them. Then the population of the both red and the blue beetle decreases. This variation not help the organism to be get survival. Here variations are not helpful for survival. In the same manner, there is another one, third illustration is there in your textbook. Some group of red beetles are living in the green bushes. Suddenly, the green, they have been get attacked by some diseases. And due to which, the availability of food has been got decreased and the beetles are been now starving. Due to the unavailability of the food, the size of the beetle get gradually get decreased. And why it has been happened? Because of environmental changes. And as the generation pass on, suddenly the disease which has been get struck by the green plants has been got rid of. And once again the beetles have got the food. As they got the food, once again their size has been got increased. I can say here a one point for that. What the character now the beetles they have got during their life, that character I can say that is as acquired character, because this character is developed during their lifetime. But this character, it can't be passed from one generation to the next generation. For example, if the populations of the beetle get increased and the plants are been affected by the disease, then the food available for the beetle decrease and their body weight also get decreased. That only I have illustrated you as an example. If after a few years the availability of the food get increased, then the body weight of the beetle also get increases. This acquired trait cannot be passed from one generation to the next because there is a no change in the genetic composition. Okay, as in the third example, the change in the beetle is happened because of the environmental factor. And that change is not a constant change, it is a temporary change, and this change has been acquired during the lifetime. Hence, we consider this one as acquired character. Okay, then what are the factor by in this and all whatever we have been learned now, we can say there is a formation of new species is going on. How the new species is formed? Let's move on. Formation of a new species from the existing species, this concept we call speciation. Okay? And accumulation of variation or physical barrier or genetic drift, natural selection and the migration, these are all the different reasons for the speciation. Then maybe we can ask a question, what are the reason for the speciation or what are the factor which led to the speciation? So remember, one is accumulation of variation, physical barrier, genetic drift, natural selection and the migration. These are all the different factor which are leads to the formation of a new species, that is speciation. So let's move on to the each and every fact. First one is accumulation of variation. The difference between the individual of the same species is called as variation. In the beginning itself we have got that one, what is the meaning of variation. And the accumulation of variation over the several generations produce the new species. That is, variation should not be that only it will be present in one generation, it will get absent in the one generation. Successively it will get transmitted from one generation to the next generation, then only there is a arise of the new species. Okay, the next, physical barrier. You are all familiar the physical barrier, such as we have mountain, river and the lakes. These isolated groups produce a variation which can produce a new species. But whereas a point to be remember here, the physical barrier, it will be not a major factor in the case of asexual reproduction. Why? In asexual reproduction, there is no need of transferring the gamete from male to the female. And even, point to be remember, in asexual reproduction particularly, who are carrying the self-pollination, there is no major impact of the physical barrier at all. Because in the self-pollinating plant, they have to transfer the pollen grain from same. From the, within the same flower, they have to transmit. As a physical barrier, it doesn't have any role in asexual reproduction and even in the self-pollinating plant. Remember this one. Whereas in the sexual reproduction, it has a major impact. Or in the cross-pollination also, the physical barrier has a major impact. Because in the cross-pollination, they have to transfer the pollen grain from one plant to the another plant or from one flower to the another flower. Hence, the physical barrier plays a very important role in the cross-pollination and the sexual reproduction. Let's move on to the next third factor, which leads to the speciation, that is genetic drift. Natural calamities or introduction of new members of the same species in the area can produce the changes in the gene pool of a population, and new variations are produced which can be produced in new species. There is a, as I said, genetic drift related one illustration. There is a sudden changes in the frequency of the gene due to some accident. It may be causes the genetic drift. Whereas in the case of the genetic drift, natural calamities or introduction of the new member of the same species in the area can produce the changes. There is either natural calamities, otherwise introduction of the new member. These are the two things which leads to the genetic drift. Next, natural selection. Only those individuals of the species which have the useful variation can adapt to the changes in the environment, survival, and other life. This organism can produce a variation and a new species. What is the meaning of that? I have given you the first illustrative example. That is some group of red beetles are living along with only one small green beetle. But crow can see only the red beetle and it can't see the green beetle. Then the green beetle got the survival advantage. Nature is selecting for them to be get fit for the environment. Hence we can consider that one as a natural selection. Whereas migration, some individuals of species may migrate to the new geographical area and adjust to the changes in the environment. They develop the new variation and produce a new species. This is also one of the best example for the formation of the new species. There is any local person, if he migrate to the other, due to the change in the environment or due to the change in the availability of the food or the other factor, he develops some new special character, and due to the some special character, he maybe can form a new species in the future. Whereas up to it now we have been gone through the concept of that is how the new species have been formed. Let's go through now about the evolution. Already at the beginning I have told you the meaning of the word evolution. It is a process of slow and a gradual change in which the simple organism become a complex. Whereas evolution, it will be formed by the two things. One is acquired and the inherited traits. Acquired trait means what and the inherited trait means what? They maybe can ask you differentiate acquired and the inherited trait. The trait which will be developed during the lifetime of an individual, it is considered as an acquired trait. For example, it can't be transmitted from one generation to the another next generation. I have learned the swimming, but it is not mandatory that my son also will learn the swimming by means of me only. I have developed that character, but it is not that he will also be. When he is born, he will try to swim by himself. It will be developed during the lifetime of individual. Okay, I have learned Japanese language. It is also developed during the lifetime. Then the character which have been developed during the lifetime, they are called as acquired. Inherited character means the character which have been came from parents to the offspring. For example, my father have a curly hair, even I too got the curly hair. My mother has a brown color eye, even I too got the brown color eye. These characters are been transmitting from
one generation to the next generation.
Such characters are called as
inherited traits.
And the inherited traits are the inherited characters. They are responsible for the evolution. And let's move on. Do we have any evidence for the evolution? There are the number of common features in the different organisms which prove the evidence to show the evolutionary relationship. The main evidence for the evolution are study of homologous organ, analogous organ, and the fossil. But I will broadly classify the evidence for the evolution into the two groups. One is paleontological evidence and another one is morphological evidence. So, first one, I'm going through the morphological evidence. As an example of morphological evidence is homologous organ, or the organ which are similar in the structure but different in the function. Example, the forelimb of the amphibian, reptile, bird, mammal have similar structure but different function. Frog is an amphibian, uses its forelimb to rise front of the body. Lizard, that is a reptile, uses its forelimb for walking and running. Birds, forelimbs are being modified as a wing for flying. Mammals use a forelimb for grasping, walking, running, swimming, flying, etc. This shows an evolutionary relationship. Did you got? Homologous organ means organs those who have common structural plan but perform different function. The another one example for the homologous organ. Next, analogous organ. The organ which are different in structure but perform similar function. I think every one of you have observed the wing of the butterfly and the bird. But both of them they look very quite different, but both of them they use for only one function, that is for flying. Did you got? Such organs are considered as analogous organs. Okay, next let's move on to the paleontological evidence. There is a fossil. In the last year, April 2019, they have asked a question: what is fossil? The remains and the relics of the dead organisms of the past are called as fossil, or the remains and the organism which are lived long time ago. From the fossil, we can know their structure in the time period which they have been lived. Then we can ask another one question here: what are fossil? What do they say about the process of evolution? First thing, we can come to know their structure in the time period which they have been lived, and the fossils of the complex recent organisms are found closer to the surface of the earth, and the fossils of the simpler organism found deeper inside the earth. The age of the fossil can be determined by the radiocarbon dating. The study of the fossil shows the evolution simple form into the complex form and their evolutionary relationship. There is another one question that maybe can ask: how you will determine the age of the fossil? The way they determine the age of the fossil, it is based on which surface of the earth they are going to begin. If the fossils are getting in the deeper portion of the earth, then they are the older. More deeper is a fossil, more is a older. If the fossil is found in the middle layer of the earth, then it will be the recent fossil. So based upon the surface of the earth crust where they are hitting, we can determine the age of the fossil. This is the one method. And the another one method is, that is radiocarbon dating. You are going to learn about this, what is a radiocarbon dating in the higher classes. That is, we have a concept called as a half-life period. We'll learn in the higher classes about that. And apart from that, even from the fossil, we can come to know that is it shows the evolutionary relationship from simple form to the complex form. How the simple organism have been evolved and he become a complex. You got it? Then how many evidence we have for the evolution? One is a paleontological evidence and another one is morphological evidence. For the morphological evidence, example as analogous in the homologous organ, whereas paleontological evidence is a fossil. Okay, now let's move on further. We have gone through what is the meaning of the word evolution and the two evidence for the evolution, as a paleontological evidence and morphological evidence. Both of the things we have learned. But the evolution, it will not take place just within 1 or 2 days. Evolution, as I told you before, it is a slow and a gradual process in which a simple organism transforms himself into advanced and the complex. In the same manner, evolution will be carried in the stages. Means that evolution will be carried in the stages bit by bit over the successive generation. For example, evolution of the eyes. In the case of planaria, you can able to observe the eyes what the planaria have, just it is a spot to detect the light. But later on, this eyes have been evolved more by the process of evolution, and they have become complex in the higher animals. For example, in the human, we have the compounds, and we have learned about the human eye. Human eye, that is, they have the capacity of to carry the process of accommodation. They can adjust itself for the near and the far object. That is how the evolution has been carried in the eyes. In the same manner, evolution of the feather. Feathers were first developed in dinosaurs, and it is used for protection of the cold. But later on, these feathers were being adopted for the flight. So then maybe we can ask you one question. There is a how the characters are being modified to determine how the organisms are close to each other. For that you can take these two examples. One is the evolution of the eyes, and even you can take the evolution of the feathers. So related to the evolution of the feather, if there is a question, you can explain it as the feathers were being first developed by the dinosaur, but later, but they used this feather to protect from the cold. But later on, these feathers were being adopted for flying in the higher animals. Evolution by artificial selection. Artificial selection in sense, in the higher class, you maybe can you will learn about a process called as molecular phylogeny. And this molecular phylogeny, it is based upon the concept of DNA sequence. And even at the beginning, you have been learned about that we can alter the DNA. Nowadays we have biotechnology. That means of that we can change the DNA, and based upon our requirement, we can design the new organism. So, human cultivated the wild cabbage for over thousands of years and produced different vegetables from it by artificial selection. So, based upon our need, we have modified the wild cabbage into the different form. Like we have a cauliflower, kale, kohlrabi, brosobi. These are the different varieties of the wild cabbage, different varieties of the wild cabbage which is been developed by main wild cabbage. And this was been took not only 1 or 2 years, it has took 2000 years. So that only as a headline we have, evolution is carried
by stages.
In the same manner, human embryology. Here not only the human embryo have been mentioned, here you can able to see we have the different embryos. In this, you can clearly recall that all the different organisms, they have been undergoing a simple and a slow gradual process, and they are becoming a complex. How the simple one is now becoming an finally, in this lesson, we have a concept called as evolution should not be equated with the progress. At the beginning of the session, I told you about some examples how the characters are being going to be get developed during the lifetime of an individual. But due to the development of the character, organism will become advanced. Sometime that character will helpful the organism to survive, sometime it may not be helpful to survive. When the new organism will be formed in the nature, it not means that old one will be get eliminated. Of course, old one will be eliminated only in one case, that is if we do not develop the new character, or if we are not able to adjust or adopt the changes in the environment.
If you compare the different organism, just one example, we have a bacteria, frog, lizard, and the human. When compared to this all organism, who is very better?
Human, bacteria.
Some of you say that human, some of you say that is bacteria. But bacteria is one of the most cosmopolitan organisms because it can live in almost all habitat. Then we can't conclude that he is a better and he is an inferior. Bacteria is a better and we are the inferior. It is not. We can't equate the evolution with the progress. If we have a better character, then he will be suitable to the environment. The main thing is here we have to remember that is organism have to adopt himself to better cope up with the environment. Did you got it? Then we can ask a question related to this fact, that is how the evolution should not be equated with progress. And finally, we have a concept of human evolution. Throughout the world, we have our species. The scientific name of the human we considered as Homo sapiens, but we'll find the different variety in the terms of color, skin color, hair, and other different characters. But even though all the humans are one, what is the reason? Because these characters are being controlled by the two factors. One factor is environment, and another one factor is genetical. Genetical factor in sense at the beginning, as I said, due to the migration. When they migrate, initially all the humans have been evolved in Africa. All the humans have been evolved from in the Africa. Some of them they have stayed and some of them have migrated to the different parts of the world due to the genetic variation. As I said, that is one is a genetic factor and another one is environmental changes in the different geographical regions. They have developed the changes in their forms in the future. So remember, then maybe can ask a question. Throughout the world, we have the different color, size, and the different characters in the human, but everyone not the same. How? Because these characters are being controlled by the two factors. One is by the environment and another one is by genetical factor, but even though all the humans are the one. And another one point to remember, all the humans are being evolved
from
the Africa and they have been migrated. They have not moved in a straight line. They have, once they have been shifted to the other places, they have came and they have merged. And due to this continuous process, we are observing the different varieties in the world. Okay?
Please subscribe, like, and share our YouTube channel, Bluebell Academy.